Hey everybody, this episode of Ars Decoded is brought to you in part by No Wave Academy. No Wave Academy provides online instructional workshops from some of today's best fine artists. Some of the artists include Mia Bergeron, Paul Christina, Nick Runke, Daniel Seagrove, John Wentz, and many more. A lot of these artists have actually been featured on Ars Decoded as well, so definitely go check out the archive to check those out. The Academy recently released an oil painting from life workshop with master oil painter Sean Cheatham. Artist Decoded is offering 10% off of all of their online workshops, so please go to nowaveacademy.com, type in AD-10 at checkout for 10% off. Now, on to the episode.
You know, as artists, that's really one of the most important things to develop. Because once you have all the skills, like you understand how to pick up a brush and lay down color, even mix color, things of that nature, that for me all turns into like more part of your intuitive toolbox. And it should kind of work in the background. So you shouldn't have to worry about how you're going to do something, but you should start to think about how do I present this dialogue, with the intuitive toolbox and get that message out.
Hey everybody, welcome to Artist Decoded episode number 154. This is your host Yoshino, and you're listening to the episode with painter Ron Hicks. I met Ron at the Gallery 1261 booth at the LA Art Show in February. My friend Dave Etheridge, who is the gallery director of 1261, introduced us. And in this episode, we were able to talk about his introduction to painting in his childhood and adolescence, and how his talents brought him to obtaining a full ride scholarship to Columbus College of Art and Design in Columbus, Ohio. We also talked about creating honestly and how an early mentor guided him to understanding his unique soul and sensibilities in his creations. He also talked about some trauma he's endured throughout his life in terms of being racially profiled, specifically by law enforcement, which was a subject that I feel is very important to talk about considering the history and present-day occurrences of racism that exists in our society. It's very troubling to hear that also because I can tell that Ron is a very kind person. Racism should be a subject of the past, but it exists, unfortunately. And even with this current situation with coronavirus, you hear about the racism against people that makes me feel very sad for the ignorance of myopically minded people. I'm glad that we were able to touch upon that subject of racism because of its relevance, and I'm glad that Ron was able to share his experiences with us and that he was vulnerable enough and open enough to be able to share these experiences. It was honestly a joy to meet Ron, and it was very easy for us to fall into conversations about life, philosophy, art, film, and everything in between. And yeah, I just really appreciate him for coming on the show. Before we begin this episode, I want to give a shout out to our sponsors at Trakel. Trakel Art Supplies offers professional grade art supplies for all skill levels. Trakel has their own line of brushes and panels, but also stocks a small selection of other professional grade art materials to complement their products. Trakel also has a variety of materials for all skill levels, so it doesn't matter if you're a master or a beginner, Trakel has all your painting and art supply needs. Most orders ship within 24 hours after being placed, free shipping on orders of $59 and more. Get a 5% discount by using the discount code AD5 at checkout to receive 5% off on all Trakel products. So go to Trakel.com and get all of your art supplies there. Also, before I forget, please go to our iTunes page and leave us that shining 5-star review because it helps for viewers just like yourself to hear about this podcast, and the more the merrier. So spread the love and leave us that positive review. Here it is, my episode and conversation with painter Ron Hicks. Hope you enjoy it. Well, thanks for coming and doing the podcast. I really appreciate it. And it's been really great to meet you over at the LA Art Fair.
Yes. It was quite the event over there. I have been making it a point to get to a lot of the art fairs that my galleries are involved in. Just to kind of take everything in, because prior to doing this, I would, had no idea what was going on. I would just send work out sometimes, and I knew they were doing fairs. But to actually come and experience has been like enlightening, and actually see, what's out there. I think that's important too.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I agree. I'm curious. So, when did you get into painting? What made you decide that you wanted to become a painter? And how has painting shaped the way that you perceive life?
So my earliest recollection comes from the time that I spent, at home with my mother. She was really a huge inspiration. And I'd say that she was an artist in her own right. But back in the day, there was this, I remember it like in Time magazine or something like that, but it was this, if you can draw Tippy the Turtle, you too could be a famous artist. There was this correspondence course. Mm. And this was before the days of, email and this the technology. So it was snail mail, and she would, do some of these lessons, send the work off. It'd come back marked up with tissue over the top of it, So it was this kind of, basically it was a correspondence course. Mm. And I would sort of sift through all of the things that I would see there, and I would, draw everything that I saw in the book. And that eventually, went, down the street to the neighbors and things of that nature, and even, messing around in school. Some of my earliest memories of me, and of course, some of the desks have changed, but the little wraparound desk you would start with, I would start these little, I call them mini murals now, but I'd start in the corner of one of my desks and in each class that I had, and work my way across the desk during the course of the year. And, usually, they frowned upon you writing on the desk, but they would allow me to kind of leave my little drawings on the desk. And they were like, oh, look what he's doing there. So those are some of my early memories.
Yeah. Personally, I just love the artwork of children because it's so unadulterated. Mm-hmm. And it's the exact definition of unadulteration. It's not filtered through the things that adults feel are relevant, such as making money and those sort of things that get secondhand passed down to a lot of people.
You're absolutely right. There's a certain sense of freedom that I think that I would constantly like to work back to. But in school, I was the guy that would just, you'd have those coloring books with the dark lines that you were supposed to stay inside. And I remember my teacher always going, no, you need to draw inside of the lines, and put the color here. This is where it's supposed to go. And I was like, well, why? I prefer to put it outside these lines, mm-hmm. And so I would make my own, coloring book over the top of the coloring book. So I knew at an early age there was a certain aesthetic or something that, I appreciated. And I always wanted to kind of break those boundaries, so to speak. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So then at what point did you start getting more into the academic side of painting?
I would say in my, this would probably be it was my junior high year, which would be kind of like middle school for, nowadays. And that was when I had a number of my instructors over the, or teachers over the years that said, oh, this guy's got some talent. But in particular, around that time, I had a number of the teachers say, hey, this guy really has something going on. We need to kind of push him in, in certain directions. So So between middle school and high school, I had, we moved from Denver to Columbus, Ohio, and they had like this Saturday art school that I was, you know, involved in. And basically what it was is you could get like a scholarship. Well, you could actually, of course, pay for the course, but, you know, moving there, we weren't, you know, we didn't have a whole lot of money or anything like that. So, you would like submit a portfolio, and, you know, so some of my teachers said, yeah, I need to put some things together and we'll just send it over to, it was actually the Columbus College of Art and Design.
Mm.
And they had like the Saturday school. So, they reached out to me and they said, hey, you know, you got a full scholarship, you know, come on in and be a part of that program. So the end of middle school and in into high school, I had these Saturday school classes, and that's where I started to get some of the, you know, the technical training.
So, okay. So you started studying in college and high school, essentially.
Yeah. Because we had actual models. Now, you could get a sense for some of the figure, you know, and they had, you know, they were obviously clothed models, but, we started out like at around that time.
Mm. A lot of the times I ask about like mentors and things of that nature. Do you remember a specific person that played a huge role into shaping you as an artist and your perspective?
Yeah, there were a number of artists. I think the shaping for me, I would say it happened in after I moved back to Denver. So I started out at the Columbus College of Art and Design, and I was majoring in fine art, a minor in illustration. And I don't know who I was listening to, but they, you know, that whole, you know, starving artist thing came up, and I started to think, gosh, I do want to get a job or something when I get out of here. Mm-hmm. So I decided, you know, when I moved back to Colorado, that I would go to the Colorado Institute of Art. And there I studied advertising design. So I thought, well, I'll work for an ad agency or, you know, something like that. So and by the way, when I did graduate, I spent maybe all of like 2 years, you know, in the ad world, because it was, you start at the bottom and someone has to die. before you can move up, and then you're like, okay, now I'm in charge of stripping negatives. Yay. You know, classified, you know?
Yeah.
So, but there was an instructor there, and his name was Rennie Bruin. And he was kind of like the guy that sort of helped shape, you know, some of the thinking that I still draw from today. And what he did for me is coming into college, I thought that, well, if you could draw, you know, things exactly like they were, you know, that you were a true artist, you know. So there was this process of taking information from one area and transferring it to another. And I remember bringing him a painting, or actually airbrush, because I, you know, the airbrush was like a wonder tool for me. And it was a Tinkerbell spreading magic dust all over the place, you know.
Yeah.
And I thought it was the greatest thing since sliced bread. And I remember taking it into the class, and he's looking at me, and I said, check this out. He goes, that's irrelevant. And I was like, huh? And he goes, well, it's irrelevant because you're a painter. And he saw something to me at that time that I didn't see, but in my drawing and painting classes, which I truly enjoyed, his approach was a little bit different. It was, you can learn how to draw, and you can learn how to, you know, going back to the transfer of information, getting things exactly, but, you know, really tapping into the heart and soul, or seeing things in an abstract way, is something that a lot of people, you know, like, miss. So instead of seeing things in a tangible way, I started to see them like very, very abstractly. So I would see things in terms of shape, value, edges, texture. Even today, I still do the same thing. Those are things that I relate to. So it started my abstract way of seeing my art and seeing even the world, actually, you know.
Yeah.
It's you know, you can look at it from surface level, but there's always these things that are happening, like, underneath that make things either great or worse for that matter.
So, yeah. I mean, I think it's interesting how, you know, even with music, you categorize things in genres, or with painting, it's, you know, realism or abstract or this and that. And we're always seeking to understand and categorize something, but really it's just pigments and paints and, you know, utilizing tools to put that on the canvas or on the panel. Right. So, speaking of just like critical thinking in general, one of the courses, probably the only course that stood out to me in college, mm-hmm. was philosophy. And I remember taking that when I was 19, and maybe I had some sort of existential crisis or something, because I, you know, at that point, you know, you're just so, it was just such a formidable moment, mm-hmm. that it just opened personally my mind up to the idea and possibility that there are things that are outside of this world that are greater than what we potentially perceive in our capitalistic minded society.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. And was that a similar feeling that you had with this teacher over at that college?
Yes, it sort of opened the floodgates for me. And I had a number of life experiences, you know, that was happening on the outside. So I came to the conclusion that, you know, this art thing, it has to be something bigger than just, you know, this small piece of, you know, like making sure people go, you know, go, hey, you painted a still life. It's like, well, big whoop. I've got a good friend of mine that actually helps me out a lot with some of my day-to-day things, you know, working with my website and that, things of that nature. And she was an aspiring artist. And she said something to me that was pretty funny but profound. She was taking all her work, doing all this work and studying art. And she was, you know, doing this thing that I just spoke of, you know, like painting like this still life. And then she came to the conclusion that her contribution is much greater than, you know, making paintings. And she said something to the effect of, the world doesn't need another bowl of oranges. In other words, what she does now is she curates shows, you know, very, very smart. And she's in Denver, been bringing some eclectic kind of things to the, I'll say the Western side of the country, if you will.
Mm, so cool. Yeah.
So I started to come to the understanding that there has to be something bigger and greater than just this. And so what my time, you know, at the Colorado Institute of Art did for me was it started me thinking beyond just that. And I think as artists, that's really one of the most important things to develop. Because once you have all the skills, like you understand how to, you know, pick up a brush and lay down color, even mix color, things of that nature, that for me all turns into like more part of your intuitive toolbox. And it should, you know, like kind of work in the background. So you shouldn't have to worry about how you're going to do something, but you should start to think about, how do I present this dialogue, you know, with that intuitive toolbox and get that message out? Because if we're constantly sitting around going, gosh, you know, if I mix cadmium red with whatever color, you know, because I've actually had some students come in with like these charts and go, well, I think it's this color. Like they'll do like these giant color charts.
Yeah.
And if you're constantly worrying about, you know, the tools that you use, you'll never get to the creative side of it, or even tap into what I think is the most important is you as an artist, you know, like who you are. And I like to think of, you know, my onion analogy, and, you know, where you have all these layers. And these layers could be from anything, from, you know, preconceived notions about how you should paint, or it could be even outside of the, you know, the art world, because I think it's, like I said, you know, art to me is bigger than that. It could be, you know, some situations in your life that may have affected you and affected you in such a way that it affects the way you create.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that we should constantly be working towards, you know, getting to the inside of that, you know, that onion, like peeling back those layers so that we can release.
Yeah. Getting to that core, as exactly. We were talking about, yes. Before.
Yes. Getting to the core.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true. Yeah, I think art is a medium, and it's a microcosm to how we think as people as well. If you really peel back those layers, as yes. you're saying, the way that you approach a painting or the way that you approach creating artwork, sort of like a personification of what you think internally. And so it's always good to, I feel, to understand and to constantly be hungry for knowledge, to continue to work on yourself internally and to be honest with that and not allow things to get buried inside your subconscious so that you can honestly create. And sometimes it takes a while for that to occur, for you to understand that.
Absolutely.
And for some people, it never happens. You know,
yes.
I always think just because you get older doesn't necessarily mean that you become wiser.
This is true.
Yeah. You just become older.
Yeah. I do believe that it shapes you. And I've had a number of experiences through my life that even informed how I even see or express art. Because I think we've talked in the past. And when you have like these experiences or things that happen in your life, it directly falls into how you perceive or what you do with your work. Unless you're, approaching your work in such a way to where it's mindless and aimless, and there's no, it becomes more of a work, you're just laying down things because you're doing it in more of a formulaic way and not really truly taking the art to heart and express yourself in that manner. I think we have to somehow interject all of that into the way that, into our working process in order for it to truly be a part of your art or your active being an artist.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever found yourself at a point where you're just phoning it in with the painting?
Phoning it in, and you mean like
to where it becomes just work, and you kind of lose that sort of spark, that sense of expression, that sense of you're trying to sell paintings so that you can have a career with the art.
You know, there is a fine line between the idea of phoning it in and actually, painting from the heart. And again, it comes from those exterior forces, wait a minute, I do need to have a career and, make money in order to survive. And the risk of not doing that means that maybe, you won't be able to, continue to do your art, and you'll have to, maybe get some sort of secondary way of creating some income. So those things factor in, and they actually affect what it is that you do. So, yeah, I would say earlier in my career, most people think of this as like painting for the masses. You kind of do things because you think that people will, say, oh, if I paint this subject matter, then people will love this and they'll pay for it and the world will be happy. And to a certain extent, maybe that is true. But the question that I started to have as I continued is, does that truly make me happy as an artist? And so, currently, the body of work that I'm working on, which is probably been about the last 14 or so years, and not necessarily working on them physically on a daily basis, but sort of thinking about this whole process, or some call it a transition. But if you've seen my paintings like 10 years ago and you see where they are now, you might look at them and go, gosh, you have totally turned the ship around and you're doing something completely way out there. But what people don't know is underneath all of my paintings prior to that, there's this abstract dialogue that eventually got covered up. Mm-hmm. And it was covered up because I thought, well, gosh, people don't want to see this. They want to see, genre type scenes. I used to, and I still do. I love to romanticize life, in my paintings, So what I think has changed now is I'm not doing as much of the tangible things. So it wouldn't be uncommon before to paint an entire like cafe scene with maybe, a couple, in a cafe having some sort of conversation. The thing that I would leave open would be, the interpretation, because I would have people come to the shows and go, well, what are they thinking? What's happening there? And I would still have that mindset of, well, what do you think is going on in this painting? Which is going to lead to, you know, my thought on, you know, how I think people should perceive, you know, my work. And it transfers into what I'm actually doing right now. So I'd say, yes, you are influenced by what you think people want. And it goes back to the onion analogy. The more of those layers you pull off, the more, and you mentioned being honest, the more honest you are with yourself and trying to figure out what it is you're really supposed to be doing, you'll uncover some things, and you may do some things that might not necessarily be marketable to, you know, to the public. But should you not do that? I don't know.
Yeah. It's interesting because we're all trying to navigate this extremely complex world. And if you're a potentially driven person, then you want to accomplish certain things with your life, whatever that may mean for, you know, each individual person. And how those sort of secondhand values get passed down to us. I mean, and, you know, you can even bring it back to these sort of educational teaching mechanisms that have been passed down from like grade school to middle school to, you know, high school and college, on how we should think and how we should intake and regurgitate information. And, you know, so it's almost like we're becoming programmed to think a certain way.
Absolutely.
And to be career oriented. And, you know, I went to business school actually, and I found photography in business school. And
oh, wow.
Yeah, and then that became kind of like, I think similar to you. Yeah, I wanted to be like, I guess, commercially successful, or I wanted, you know, I wanted to make money off of it, you know?
Yeah.
And then at some point I just realized, wait, I'm not really happy doing this. This doesn't really serve me the way that I initially thought it would. But I, you know, similar to you, I still had that approach of seeing it as my art form, and maybe even potentially, I mean, I'm not trying to project onto you, but I'm just talking about myself, but like kind of lying to myself that this is actually my artwork, you know?
Yeah.
Even though it was through a more commercialized medium with a more commercialized audience. And yeah, I don't know. I mean, but, you know, in hindsight, when you look back at it, or when I look back at it, you know, I have to give myself some sort of kindness and forgiveness throughout the process, because that's just how I intake the information at that time.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
It goes back to your when you know, as you get older, you get wiser. Maybe not necessarily true, but I do think that, you know, with years, you know, you do have time to reflect. And my 20-year-old self would be like, yeah, this is it. And this is what I should be doing. But, you know, after you sit back and you start to reflect, and you realize maybe that isn't all there is to this. Like I did with my transformation in college, you know, it's like, yeah, there's gotta be something more to it, but you have to allow yourself, you know, the room, or, well, if it ever happens, because some artists, you know, are satisfied in, and I don't knock it at all. You know, if you get on something and you do it to the end of your career, that's valid, because maybe that's where your life, you know, or your expectations has taken you. But the honesty part is when you start to realize these things, what do you do about it? That's when it becomes, you know, disingenuous, or you start working in a pretentious way.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Yeah. No,
for me at least.
Yeah. We were talking about this before, that it comes down to intention, because I was using that example of Peter Lindbergh, the photographer, and through his photographs, a majority of them, maybe 90% of them, are black and white, and they're portraits of people. And a lot of them, I mean, it's almost like he never changed and he was always the same person. But I think for him, it was very honest.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But for other people, maybe they might just be phoning it in. So it's just the intent of what someone is trying to do and how honest they are with their... And I feel like from a viewer's perspective, you can feel that from someone, mm-hmm. if it's contrived or if it's honest or what have you.
And for me, you know, from a personal level, which I think the work that I'm doing now has more of a personal piece to it. I used to take, you know, things that, you know, happened to me earlier, and in full disclosure, I have to say that, you know, I was like racially profiled from, you know, age 15 all the way up to like 45, you know.
And what do you mean in what regard?
Well, I'll say this, you know, I used to get pulled over, you know, harassed by, you know, police officers for no reason. You know, I would, they would say, well, let me see your license. And all of a sudden, that's when everything would start, you know. And I might say something like, well, you know, why'd you pull me over, officer? You know, it's like, well, get out the car. And then it would begin like that. And then all of a sudden, there might be, you know, 7 to 10 police officers. And then there's this...
it's like perfect timing right now.
I know. You hear that in the background. The cops,
Ron, they're coming to get you again.
I'm telling you. Well, I have developed, you know, somewhat of a PSD. What is it?
PTSD.
PTSD. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh no, actually, it's a fire department. So you're good.
It still works though.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I'm sorry. Continue.
Yes, I developed like a PTSD over, you know, having, you know, hands on the steering wheel, 10 and 2, you know, when I see like flashing lights, like that would have affected me. Actually, it still does to this day, because I would just get pulled over. I remember I would get pulled over just walking down the street, you know, which is... this is just some crazy things. Let me see your license. And, yeah. To the point where I've had to, I've, you know, been handcuffed. I had my son in the car at one point, you know, when he was a young boy, he's probably about 3 years, maybe a little bit more than that. And, I remember him asking me in one case, like, well, you know, daddy, are they going to shoot you? And, you know, he's looking at these lights flashing, mm-hmm. you know, and they were telling me, get out of the car, hands up, you know, and then you get tackled and, you know, yeah. Oh yes.
Wow. You got tackled.
Tackled. Like, so hands in the air, they have you like lace your fingers and they run.
So this has happened on multiple occasions, like over 10 to 15 times, you think?
More than that. I would really? Say during, you know, from that period of 15 to 45, I would say at least 30, at least. Yeah.
Wow, that's insane.
And I have no, you know, I'm not angry or anything like that. I understand that like a police officer's job is his job, and they probably run into a lot of, you know, bad people. But I just think that the process, you know, when you do realize, or if you don't have, you know, enough cause to, you know, because I wasn't doing anything, you mm-hmm. know, when I would get pulled over, I would just, you know, be driving around with my car and all of a sudden lights would go on. And in many of the cases, there wouldn't even be an explanation for, you know, why they were pulling me over.
And yeah, which is against the law.
Yes. No. Yeah. But back then I didn't know that, you know, I had the right to say or do anything about that. And even if I did, the nature, and I think that...
You might have just aggravated it.
Yes, and I'll tell you what conditioned me in this in these situations, because I remember being in the back of a police car, and for those of you who have not been in the back of one, with your hands cuffed, there's not a lot of room, and you kind of, and I'm 6 foot, so there's not a lot of room. You can't sit straight, you know, so you're to the side. Mm. And I remember like one officer, because I was asking him, and this is one of the first cases where, you know, I started to get that conditioning, so to speak. I asked him, I said, well, officer, I am handcuffed. I'm in the back of your car. Can you tell me why? And then he said something, well, you have a warrant. And I go, well, how did I get a warrant if I haven't done anything? And then he sarcastically said, well, when you do bad things, you know, bad things happen to you. And I thought, okay. And then I kept hearing, like, over the radio, you know, there was, like, all this, you know, chatter. And then I said something to the effect of, I said, shouldn't you be out, like, catching, like, real criminals? And then he jumps out the car. And he comes around to the back, opens the door up, and he pulls this, you know, like, a little club or whatever, thing was on his side out. And he puts it up to my head, like, you know, like he swings at me with it. And it didn't hit me or anything like that, but it made me flinch. And I thought, okay, I should probably shut my mouth now. So there was this, you know, a bit of fear, you know, because when you're in that position, you're kind of helpless. You can't, you know, there's not a whole lot you can do except, I thought I was going to get hit, but obviously he probably wasn't going to follow through with it, but it sure felt like he was going to do that. But the conditioning of it was, okay, let me, you know, not say anything and leave it be what it is. Yeah. Let it be what it is.
Yeah.
And so if you can imagine, you know, from being, you know, a young man, you know, and you're constantly having like these little episodes, and they usually happened, you know, mainly, you know, so after I got my, you know, like my driver's license, and you know, my brother and I have a twin brother.
Mm. Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. His name is Don.
And Don
so,
and Ron.
Yes, Don and Ron. So we would just be, you know, driving, you know, back from work or school or something like that, because we were really close. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we would, you know, into a parking lot or something like that. And for me, it was just, it started to become more terrifying to be, you know, alone and not know what was going to actually happen. So when I see things like, you know, that happen in the news where some of these guys are, you know, being harassed or in some cases even, you know, shot or killed, I can totally see how that could happen in those situations, because I've actually had guns drawn and everything, you know, and you can see them. So I could totally see how it could happen. And so how that informs what I'm doing now is I tried to take that information and compartmentalize it and go, okay. Because during those years, and I was having shows, you know, like in my, you know, like
that's so crazy,
like my 30s and things of that nature, and people would never know this was going on, but I would compartmentalize it and just put it away and just not really deal with it. But things like that, you can't just leave not dealt with, I should say. They're always going to be a part of your psyche. So even in some of my works, you know, when I'm, you know, playing with some of the abstract shapes and the dialogue, you know, some of it seeps into it, because I can't help but not think about it at some times, even when I'm, you know, I'm working. So I think when you're painting and you're truly expressing yourself as an artist, it comes out some way or another.
Yeah.
Even though it might not be something that's conscious, it comes out.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean, even having one instance like that would be extremely traumatic for most people. You know, I think this illusion of freedom, and also the illusion, I mean, I guess it's not really illusion, but there is racism that exists out there still.
Yeah.
And which is ridiculous, because as we were talking about before, it's just the skin color is really just melanin in your, that exists in your skin.
Yeah.
So there should really be no reason for division, but absolutely, people see in colors, which I think is healthy for us to talk about, because it helps educate people about how silly it is in certain ways, but also how severe and serious the issues are of racism that currently exists in our country.
Oh, absolutely.
But I'm curious, so how did you begin to deal with some of those traumatic situations that happened to you? You said from the age of 15 to 45,
mm-hmm.
where there's these potential scenarios where there could be a police brutality situation. How did you deal with that? And did you utilize painting to help you deal with that? Or did you go to therapy or?
I think my art was my therapy. I didn't really go to therapy. And for me, you know, when you're in it, you don't realize you're in it, or you don't realize that there's anything that's happening that, you know, might be affecting your psyche or anything of that.
Well, nature. Also when it happens in such frequency too,
it, right? Yes, it becomes,
almost becomes normal.
It became the norm, and that's just the way it is. And a lot of, the people that I've, you know, shared my story with, you know, they'll sit down and go, wait a minute, what happened? Really? Are you serious? You know, I didn't realize that, you know, that kind of thing happens. And for me, I kind of let it be what it was, you know, because it was the norm. It was it's the way it is. And honestly, it's not until like in more recent years where I really started sitting down and kind of analyzing, you know, what happened in my work, and mostly in, you know, my you know, when I have my private painting time, if you will, if you want to call it that, mm-hmm. you know, that's where I have a chance to sort of, you know, flesh some of those things out. And not in such a way to where I'm trying to be an activist or anything like that. I don't necessarily, you know, see myself as being that person, but I can only go by what has happened to me and, you know, and deal with, you know, what's happening here. Mm. It's hard to, you know, heal someone else when you're hurting.
Yeah, definitely.
You really have to solve your situation before you can really go out and help someone else. And yeah. I don't know if my situation is, you know, so dire to where, you know, I'm on the brink of, you know, collapse, because, and I've learned to deal with, you know, that. And the art has been, you know, that vehicle to, you know, to deal with it, you know, because it's so, going back to high school, you know, most of my time was spent, you know, like my study halls was spent, you know, in the art room. Mm-hmm. So that was my getaway.
Yeah.
You know, and the same thing, you know, when I was in college. And even now, it's like, you know, my studio is like my place of refuge. So mm-hmm. I would say it helped me cope or deal, or it was a place to go to where I could create and just, you know, exist.
Yeah.
So
Do you think that painting has been a way for you to seek acceptance in certain ways based off of some of the traumatic situations that you've been through, and a way for you to be able to relate to people?
I don't know if I would go that far, because like, so my world sort of revolves around, you know, the work and then me. And then outside of that, I guess you could say there's this exterior shell that I keep all of that on the inside, you know, with the exception of now talking about this.
Yeah.
You're like my therapist now.
I know.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And what's the fee?
Yeah. $300 an hour. Yes, you can Venmo me, yes. And I also accept PayPal.
So I would, because I learned to sort of, you know, accept, you know, some of these things, you know, and see them as norms, they don't seem abnormal or as much so. But as I look back and I reflect, you know, on them, then I start to go, huh. You know, so I think that, like, even now, so in terms of acceptance, I don't necessarily think that I've had the feeling that I was unaccepted, because I've always been embraced by, you know, for every bad story there's 100 good stories. Mm-hmm. You know, I've always been around people that, you know, help champion the cause and help me move into, you know, the right space. So that outweighed the, you know, the amount of some of these other things that have happened. But I will say that, as I said a little earlier, I would kind of compartmentalize things and just kind of tuck it away and go, okay, well, that's norm, leave it over there, and not really deal with it. So now I have kind of taken this position of being like a person that opens up dialogue, and I can use my art to open up dialogue and not necessarily come up with answers or anything of that nature, but just create a space, you know, in my work to where, and I've had this happen several times at some of my shows even, where people will, you know, open up and perceive some of the works in a certain way. And I'm totally okay with that. Mm. So if you were to ask me about my work right now and say, well, Ron, what is this piece about? I would probably say, well, what do you think it's about? Mm. And, it's interesting. I had recently had an interview with, the local news in Denver, and the reporter that was interviewing me, he was asking me, well, you got to know what it's about. And I told him, well, I do know what it's about to me, but I can't take that information and put it on you. You know, I can't be responsible, in other words, for how you should feel about my work, because first of all, that would be egotistical, you know, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And then it would destroy your experience. And I don't know if I told you this story before, but I'll kind of share a little, like a little piece of it.
Yeah.
You know, I was in one of my galleries, and there was this young lady that was having this she was visibly upset about one of my paintings. And
okay.
And I don't know what country she was from, but it could have been in the Middle East or something like that. But she was looking at one of my paintings, and this was prior to doing some of the body of work that I'm currently working on. And it's probably about maybe, I'd say like 7 or 8, maybe 8 years ago. So I was just leaving the gallery, and she's crying. And I go, and I overheard her say, "This painting is about a stoning." A stoning. And I go, what? Mm. A stoning. And I felt as though I needed to go rescue my painting. Because I was like, no, this is not about a stoning. This is about love. You know, because I told you I like to romanticize life. So I go over to her, introduce myself, say, "I happen to overhear you. My name is Ron Hicks. And let me tell you what the painting is about." You know, so I went to this elaborate explanation about what the painting was about. She looks at me and she's like, you know, and she had mascara on, so it was kind of running. She's like, "I don't care what you say to me. This painting is about a stoning." And then I stepped back and I said, "Duly noted." And from that day forward, I started to adopt this different way of seeing how I should present my paintings. It's not for me to tell you what to get out of it, but it's for you to understand, good or bad for me, you know, what you get out of it, and help you, you know, with how you perceive the work. Because when I'm dead and gone, and just to say there's some works out there, you won't have the benefit of me, you know, standing there to try to explain it. And hopefully, well, I don't know.
Well, that's what the audio description's for.
Yes. There will be someone, you know, maybe making up some stuff, you know.
Yeah. Ron Hicks's painting is about the perception of.
Exactly. You know? But, and that's why I'm kind of leaving them a little more open-ended, because it can't be just about that. And at the beginning of our conversation, those feelings that I had about how, you know, I should be perceiving my art, I'm having it about how my art should be, you know, perceived now. It's like, it's harder and harder for me to say, "Hey, you need to get this out of my work or else." Mm. So I've had several instances at some of my art events where, you know, people will come in and we'll start having this conversation. So there was like several explanations that I had during the course of the night, and each one of the explanations were, you know, was very valid. Now, if I had told each one of those persons, "Nah, that's not what it's about. This is what you need to get out of it," it would have totally kind of taken their experience with the painting and destroyed that. And I think that when people, you know, especially if you appreciate a work enough to buy it and put it on your walls and take it away, you should be allowed to enjoy that experience. And it shouldn't just be about, well, what is this artist doing? Is he going anywhere? Okay, I think I'll take it, because that to me is so cold. Mm-hmm. I'd like to believe, even though I don't know if this is necessarily the reality, but I'd like to believe that someone has, you know, some sort of connection, you know, with the work, and they've taken that to heart, and it's something that they'll love and cherish for years.
Yeah.
Of course, it's maybe not the reality.
Well, that's your romantic viewpoint coming out, the romanticization. I always think it's interesting to talk to people about art, whether it's their own art or, you know, another, like a film or something, and understanding their viewpoint, or even music, mm-hmm. and understanding the viewpoint and where they're coming from, because it really tells about a lot about the person's inner dialogue and how deeply or not so deeply someone thinks about or perceives a piece of artwork. You know, it's interesting too to see people observe people at a museum, and and it also is kind of a metaphor for just like glossing over things in life. If someone just kind of takes things for face value, or maybe it's a thing of what that person's going through during that day, you know, or, and the time that they have at that museum. But I think with just life in general, like the beautiful aspects are just subtlety and nuance. And the more mm-hmm. that you can appreciate, you know, even as a painter, like the, like each sort of brushstroke and each little nuance, like even having like just a little piece of paint that just like kind of mm-hmm. extrudes in a certain way or hangs off a canvas or something, you know, I think there's just something beautiful about, and this is my romantic side coming out for everyone to hear, but, yeah, I mean, I think, you know, that just, and it goes back to this idea of gardening, you know, and spending mm-hmm. that time, in your garden and, you know, this planting the seed, which becomes, you know, a beautiful rose.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
I think, and just having the appreciation for those things is what makes life really great.
Yeah. Yeah. And everybody has their own perception because, yeah. And that's the beauty of, you know, I'll speak specifically about art. That's the beauty of, you know, art. Everyone has their own take in how they see it. Mm-hmm. You know, some people, you know, I've talked to some people, it's like, oh, I see a face in there, you know, and that's what they get out of it. It doesn't get any deeper than that.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, oh, no, I didn't see the face. I still don't. But yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
You know, whereas, you know, some others might reflect as you did and really take it, you know, to a larger meaning of, you know, how it relates to life, you mm-hmm. know, and our existence.
Mm-hmm.
But we are all human beings that are, I guess, constantly dying.
Yeah.
we're moving towards.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that has something to do with, you know, artists as they get older or actually anyone for that matter, where you start to reflect on things. You know, that might be something to take into consideration, your own mortality and how you see or view things. But I will say this with my work. I think I told you this before when we've chatted in the past, that I just don't want to live with any kind of regrets about what I'm doing with my work. And I don't want to get to, you know, my last days and go, gosh, I wish I would have explored some of those things and not have the opportunity or really have these regrets about not doing it. Because I would have rather had lived at something and failed than to not even tried it and still failed.
Yeah. No, that's true. I mean, I feel very much the same way.
Yeah.
You know, I was just thinking about this the other day, and I think I wrote this down, that I'm not afraid of death, but I'm afraid in death in life.
Mm.
And
yes.
Yeah, I guess that's, you know, my fear is just phoning it in and not truly living. And whether this is, again, the romantic thing coming out, but why not live a life that is, that you love passionately and live for and are curious about and are constantly intaking information. I think that's who cares about money, you know, like, yes, money is a means to survive and make things comfortable, but too much comfortability. There's a good amount of comfortability. Mm-hmm. I'm not knocking comfortability, but if you're too comfortable and you're not curious anymore, then for me, there's something wrong with that.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So I can only speak for myself, but
no, but I totally understand that feeling of death, because that would be, the living dead, you know, in a sense, because
it's a metaphor for a zombie.
Yes.
Essentially.
Yes. You would be a zombie.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think a lot of people are zombies. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know,
but if we get used to that being the norm and we never get out of that cycle, then, you know, maybe you never realize that you're sort of stuck in that space.
Yeah. 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 I've been thinking about that a lot too. Just so from my experiences in training and fighting and stuff like that, being a martial artist, this idea of creating your own new norm and utilizing these habits that develop over time to essentially redefine yourself and to constantly redefine yourself and to open that up and extract what exactly you're trying to get out of life. And, maybe to my benefit and detriment, but I think about these things a lot. But let's see. I have one more question that I ask to most guests. Mm-hmm. Do you have any advice for artists and creatives?
I'm going to sound like I'm being redundant, but my advice is, whatever level you end up at, or wherever you take, you know, your career, just constantly keep pulling those layers off of the onion and get to the core of what it is that you're supposed to be doing. Because for me, I think it's the only way to truly speak as a, you know, as an artist. If you continue to just be a surface person, I mean, you may have a great career and that may be okay, but maybe there's something deeper, a deeper contribution that you have, and that something that you may unlock by, you know, delving into some of these things. So constantly keep seeking for ways to do that. And that doesn't mean these have to be like huge jumps, you know.
Yeah.
It could be some subtle things that happen over the course of your entire lifetime that, you know, may go unnoticed by the average person, but you know it. We mentioned the idea of being a zombie. There is just depth in that. I mean, you just go along with the flow and that's it. So if we don't want to be artists that paint or react in a somewhat pretentious way, then you have to kind of seek who you are. And no one has your signature, you know. There have been many things that have been done, and you know how they say there's nothing new under the sun. And truthfully, there's been a lot of things done in the art world that are just regurgitated or done over and over again, but they're never done with your core perspective. Mm-hmm. So that would be my advice.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thanks so much for doing this, and you got to catch a flight, so.
Yeah, I guess I should be rolling.
Yeah, yeah. I appreciate this, and thank you for opening up and being vulnerable, and also just, yeah, it was great to meet you at the LA Art Fair.
Oh, my pleasure, man. Yeah, it's been fun.
Yeah. Cool. Well, thanks so much. Music for the podcast is by Rarebit, a.k.a. Justin Dosher Hopkins. Creative producer is Kelly Kekich, and editing help by Matthew A. Paul.